It is a pleasure to be here with you tonight. Before we get started, a couple of things I do want to note. First of all, I want to thank John personally for inviting me here tonight. It's very, very enjoyable. I've been with IWP now, gosh, you're right, it's probably even before 1985. I was coming over here as a guest speaker, so I have a long and wonderful relationship with this terrific institution. And number two, I don't see her here, but I'd like to thank Jack Tierney and Katie Bridges for their kindness in arranging everything. And I finally just want to thank really the unsung heroes of IWP, who set up the chairs and make the coffee and do the what we would call the donkey work, and are never seen behind. They work behind the scenes and are never seen out front. And I also want to thank you for coming out tonight. There were some horrible weather reports here, and you nevertheless braved it to be here tonight, and I'm very, very deeply appreciative of that. What I want to do is sort of start off my presentation and my lecture with a story that could be true or could not be true. And it is a story that really sets the tone for what we're going to be discussing here tonight. And it, in order to do so, what we have to do is sort of telescope back into history. And we're going to telescope back to from the 40th president, Ronald Reagan, back to the 16th president, Abraham Lincoln, talking about the first president, George Washington. And I don't know how many of you saw that wonderful movie, Lincoln, directed and produced by Steven Spielberg, and the marvelous, almost eerie depiction of Abraham Lincoln by Daniel Day-Lewis. He was absolutely terrific. But if you remember, he told that wonderful story about George Washington, and he told a wonderful story about Ethan Allen. And the story goes that Ethan Allen, of course, who was one of Washington's most loyal subordinates and a great war marshal for George Washington, after the war was over, after the dust settled, after all the emotions settled down, the United States was a country, a brand new country, Ethan Allen went to London, to visit London, and he was treated with great dignity. He was treated as a prominent visitor. He met a number of key people in London. And then one day he was invited out, whether it was a weekend or an evening, not relevant, but he's invited out to a country estate by some very senior dignitary in London, and he graciously accepts the invitation, and they're sitting down for dinner one evening. And as is the case, General Allen had to use the facilities. So in this case, he went out to the outhouse. So he goes to the outhouse, and he has his lantern with him. So he goes to the outhouse and opens the door. And I don't know whether he stood up or sat down. That's irrelevant to our story. But the fact of the matter is, as he turns around and he walks out, here is a portrait of George Washington on the outhouse door. So he goes back to dinner, and he's sitting at dinner, acts as if nothing had ever happened. And the host looks at him and is waiting and waiting and waiting, and Allen says nothing. So finally the host says, "Did you happen to notice the portrait of George Washington on the outhouse door?" And he says, "Oh, yes." I said, "I think it's a wonderful place for it." So the host is absolutely dumbstruck. He said, "Well, why do you say that?" And he says, "Well, it's been my experience, sir, that nothing makes an Englishman crap faster than the sight of George Washington." And that's kind of a nice way to segue. Let's telescope back about 200 years to Ronald Reagan, because nothing made the Kremlin leaders' biological functions move faster than the sight of Ronald Reagan, or an image of Ronald Reagan. But what I want to do is sort of is sort of take a look at this and sort of telescope back in history and take a look at what the influences were on Reagan. I want to sort of divide this up in a way so that we can examine the deep influences on Reagan. We're not going to spend a lot of time on this. The challenges that he acquired, the assets that he acquired, and then what he did with those assets. And we really have to start actually very, very briefly by going back and looking at him as a young actor or an actor in the late 1940s. He's a B actor, and he is a Democrat, a liberal Democrat, but he is increasingly concerned about the spread of communism in the movie industry. And he, because of his charm, because of his intelligence, which people often overlook, because of his ability to organize, he is made the president of the Screen Actors Guild. And as the president of the Screen Actors Guild, he begins to witness firsthand efforts by the American Communist Party to begin to infiltrate the movie industry. And he becomes an informant for the FBI. Now, informant is not a dirty word. A source is not a dirty word. In fact, my dear friend Dave Major, when Dave took over the position that John just referred to as the head of counter, he was the first head of counterintelligence programs, and this is in August, September of 1985, he had his first meeting with President Reagan, and President Reagan said to him, you know, I worked for you guys. I was an informant for you guys. I worked against the Communist Party. He wore this like a badge on his chest. And in my opinion, I won't go into detail, but in my opinion, it just shows great courage because it's a reflection in many ways of what we're experiencing over the past week, asking Americans to come forward and do what we have to do in order to make the country just that much safer. So he never lost that sense of himself, and he never lost that sense of the fact that he was doing a noble thing. We carry it forward to his period as governor of the state of California. I won't go through all of it, obviously, but I'm going for some of you at beyond a certain age, okay, what I'm going to reel off here will probably have some resonance. 1969, University of California at Berkeley. Campus violence, the agitators want a people's park. Reagan is willing to call out the National Guard to settle the issue. November 6, 1973, Symbionese Liberation Army murders the superintendent of schools for the Oakland County Oakland City school system for wanting to implement identification cards for students. February 19th, this is on his watch. He's the governor of the state of California from 1967 until 1975. So this is on his watch. February 19th, 1974, the kidnapping of Patricia Hearst. 2 months later, Tanya, robbery of the Hibernia Bank in San Francisco. A year and a half later, Tanya arrested by the FBI in San Francisco with Wendy Yoshimura, and we're now looking for Daniel DeFries, also known as General Cinque. Many of you remember that. And May 16th, 1974, many of you have the image of that shootout and that horrendous fire in which the Symbionese Liberation Army, a radical leftist group, went up in flames and died inside the fire. So this, all of this is occurring on his watch as the governor of the state of California. So this sort of informs his background. These are some of the elements that he's carrying with him into the presidency in January of 1981. Now, let's go back and take a look at what he inherits. When he becomes the president of the United States, what does he inherit? Well, from 1966 until 1974, there were no federal prosecutions of espionage. None whatsoever. And from 1975 Until 1989, there were 72 prosecutions for espionage. So it gives you a little bit of a sense that things are happening. Things happened during that particular period of time. What is the size of the threat that he is facing? Well, we don't have numbers. I can't stand here, certainly, and give you the numbers of KGB officers and GRU officers, excuse me, assigned here in the United States. But what we do know is this. We know that the numbers of Soviet personnel operating here in the United States was growing. And it was growing, I don't want to oversell it by saying exponentially, but it was growing at a steady rate, and we were doing nothing about it. Previous administrations were doing nothing about it. The attitude was, well, it's just something that we are going to have to accept. So he faced a Soviet KGB threat and a GRU threat nationwide. He faced it in Washington, D.C., out of the embassy here in Washington, also faced it from the trade mission here. He faced it from the agricultural office here. He faced it from the Soviet military attaché office on Tung Law Street. He faced it in New York, where Soviet KGB and GRU officers were operating out of the Soviet mission to the United States, one of the largest presence they had. Also at the United Nations Secretariat, not to mention the consulate in San Francisco. But they also had force multipliers. They also had all the Eastern European services, which they had created in the wake of the end of the Second World War, which were in fact nothing more than functionaries of the Soviet Union, also with consulates around the country, also with an embassy here. We also had the Cuban presence at the United Nations, and we had a Cuban presence here in Washington, even when they weren't recognized because they were being covered by the Czech embassy. They were represented by the Czech embassy here. Many tend to forget the fact that we, during this period of time, between 1974, and I couldn't give you the exact year, maybe somebody can help us out, between 74 and 78, we recognized East Germany. People tend to forget, but now with East Germany gone, there was an East Germany. And we recognized for the first time East Germany. So they were represented at the United Nations. They were represented at an embassy here in Washington. And then finally, you had what? You had Nixon's recognition of the People's Republic of China as the legitimate representative of the people of China, moving the Taiwanese back to a second level. So suddenly you have UN representation, forgive me, PRC representation at the United Nations, and you have, at that time we used to call it LOPRC, the Liaison Office of the People's Republic of China here in Washington, D.C. So you had this growing volume of diplomatic representatives, of which there were intelligence officers, and you have no commensurate increase in the counterintelligence capability to meet that threat. This is what he is confronting. There is growing boldness at the same time. It's not just a matter of numbers. It's a growing boldness. It's a thumbing your nose, so to speak, because they know that the philosophy, the political attitude is that we aren't going to do anything. And the example that I use actually telescopes down the road to 1984 during the Reagan administration. When Reagan was later told about this, and he, from what I understand, he was not a happy camper when he heard this. The conventional view, or I should say the conventional wisdom, is that when a high-level diplomatic exchange is occurring at the most senior level, that an intelligence service is not going to conduct any operations. They don't want blowback. They don't want flap. So they'll essentially discontinue their operations for a period of time before and a period of time afterward. That's conventional wisdom. The reality was, in 1984, I was part of the surveillance. I was a part of one of about almost 100 people that we had out that day. a 75-year-old grandmother from East Germany by the name of Alice Mickelson. She's the type of individual you're going to open the door for, you're going to give up your seat for. She is servicing an Army double agent at a restaurant at the Baltimore-Washington International Airport at the very same moment that Andre Gromyko is meeting President Reagan in the White House. Unprecedented. Absolutely unprecedented. But it happens. And it gives you an illustration of the boldness that they were beginning to exercise. Okay. So you have a growing, at the same time, people don't have their heads in the sand at all. There's a growing awareness of this threat. And I telescope back to when I lecture, I tell my students this. One of the presidents who was given, who I still can't quite understand this, who was given very little credit or virtually no credit for accelerating counterintelligence was President Jimmy Carter. Carter inherited what? He inherited the fallout of the Nixon years. You had 2 years of Gerald Ford trying to remedy the problem, trying to overcome COINTELPRO, Operation Chaos, all of the different agencies of the government who are allegedly committing criminal acts against the American people, trying to develop methods of transparency, trying to win the loyalty back of the American people, belief in their systems. Carter takes this over. He becomes president January 20th, 1977. And what does he inherit? Well, he inherits. How many of you remember The Falcon and the Snowman? Remember Christopher Boyce and Andrew Dalton Lee? That occurs 5 days before Jimmy Carter is inaugurated as president of the United States. So he's confronted with this right off the bat. And then you also have what? You also have William Holden Bell. Remember William Holden Bell in Hughes Aircraft, all right? And what is Carter willing to do? Carter is willing, at this point, we've identified William Holden Bell as giving away what they call, I think it's the LPIR, low probability of intercept radar. And Bell had given that up to who? Bell had given that up to a Polish businessman by the name of Marion Zaharsky. Carter calls the hard shot, orders the arrest of Bell, orders Bell, or actually arranges with Bell, to be what? To be an informant back against Zaharsky, and Zaharsky is arrested, and Zaharsky is convicted and jailed. So we have the first arrest of a Polish businessman here in the United States, a Polish agent, or maybe even a Polish intelligence officer. But the main contribution in terms of investigative activity, which I always go back to, is what we call the Lemonade case. And Lemonade was started out as nothing more than a basic double agent case. It was a joint operation between the FBI and the NIS, and we walked a Navy lieutenant commander onto a Soviet cruise ship called the Kazakhstan. We walked him on, and he volunteered to provide information on sonar in the Atlantic, working against the submarines. They grabbed them just like this. So moving this thing forward, we wind up seeing what? We wind up seeing him being handled not by one, but by three KGB officers. Two out of the United Nations Secretariat, and one out of the SMUN. The Enger, Valdik Enger, and Rudolf Chernaev are working in the at the UN Secretariat, and Vladimir Zinyakin is employed at the Soviet UN mission. We are also blessed, or Carter was blessed, because he had one of the finest Americans serving as his attorney general, Griffin Bell. Bell said, he wrote a book about this. He wrote a book called Taking Care of the Law with Ron Charnow, I think. And he said, I'm going to get me a spy, okay? That's basically what he said, I'm going to get me a spy. And Bell looked at this case, and said, well, why don't we arrest these guys? State Department said, well, you can't arrest them. Why can't I arrest them? Well, we never did that before. So what he did was he had his own attorneys inside DOJ go back and take a look at the issue of what? Diplomatic immunity. And what he found out was, what they told him was, these people don't have diplomatic immunity. Once they go from the Soviet mission to the UN, we call it simply the SMUN, once they go from the SMUN and go to the UN Secretariat, United Nations Secretariat, they become international employees and don't have the same level of diplomatic immunity. Gotcha. Okay? But what does Carter do? Carter authorizes the arrest of the two of them. They give Zinyakin an unindicted co-conspirator. He goes back to Moscow. The other two go to Atlanta Federal Penitentiary. And we, in exchange, when they finally exchange, we get five Soviet dissidents. Dissidents which Soviets wanted to get rid of them, plays right into Carter's human rights policy of his human rights policy, and they later become a thorn in his in the Soviet side. What about the legislative side? What does Reagan inherit on the legislative side? Well, he inherits, number one, he inherits the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence. And he also inherits the House Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence. Now, many people would criticize this, but I don't. I view it as a step forward. I view it as the Congress now stepping up and taking responsibility for something that they should have been involved in for the previous 30 or 40 years. Now Congress is saying, in the wake of Watergate, that we are going to take an active role in oversight of the intelligence community. But more importantly, from my standpoint, as an operator in the field, as someone investigating these people, they are a gateway. They are a gateway into Congress that is going to provide us with what? Legislative relief. And the legislative relief, the two most important bedrock, even today, despite all of the other the progress that we have made over these many decades, the two bedrock pieces of legislation that were passed on Carter's watch are the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act in October of 1978 and the Classified Information Procedures Act in October of 1979. Okay, so these are two pieces of legislation which Ronald Reagan inherits. Okay, now, just go back here for a moment if you don't mind. Yeah, when Reagan is elected, Reagan takes office on January 20th, 1981. Reagan's counterintelligence policy is informed by two separate individuals, information from two separate individuals. One of them is Oleg Gordievsky, and the other one is Vladimir Vetrov. Gordievsky is a KGB officer. He has been a KGB officer since 1962. He served for almost 23 years. He was joined the KGB in 1962, from 63 to 65. It's important that you get a sense of this. From 63 to 65, he served in Moscow Center. From 66 to 1970, he served in Copenhagen, where he organized illegals covering Scandinavia, Ireland, Britain, and the Australia-Asia region. Went back to Moscow Center for 2 years, spent the next 5 years online PR in Copenhagen. That's when British SIS recruited him. Okay? And then goes back to Moscow Center for 4 more years, where he was asked to write a history of the KGB. He had access to everything. And then he comes out in 1982, and the British very cleverly get him a promotion to deputy resident by PNGing the deputy resident. So he basically moves up and replaces his boss. I mean, I can't imagine a more ideal position to be in for a CIA officer than to have the deputy resident recruited. I mean, that's a nirvana, all right? So what is he What does he do? Well, Gorbachev's position is so important that toward the end of his stay in London, he's actually preparing reports, intelligence reports, almost on a daily basis to give you a sense of his access. Obviously, you'd know because he's the deputy resident, but to give you a sense, toward the end of his stay, Gorbachev is now a leading light. He's not the secretary general yet, but he is very, very close to it. He makes a guest visit to London, and Gordievsky is preparing his reports, his intelligence report, which he's feeding to the British at the very same time. What is most important when he comes out, when Gordievsky comes out in 1982 and makes contact, now he can talk to them. Everything else was impersonal while he was inside. Now he can sit down and talk to them. He briefs them about what? He briefs them about Operation Ryan. And Operation Ryan was an operation that was announced at the highest level. And it had been in effect since May of 1981 and had been engaged. It meant that the KGB and the GRU had been engaged in the largest peacetime operation in history. Now, if you'll allow me to just read this for a moment, just to give you a little bit of a sense of what this is. And what I'm reading actually from is Christopher Andrews' book called Defend the Realm, and he talks about Ryan. He says, in a secret speech to a major KGB conference in May 1981, the ailing Soviet leader, Leonid Brezhnev, denounced the policies of President Ronald Reagan, who had taken office at the beginning of the year, as a serious threat to world peace. He was followed by then-serving chairman of the KGB, Yuri Andropov, who was to succeed him as Soviet leader 18 months later. To the astonishment of most of the audience, Andropov announced that by decision of the Politburo, for the first time in their history, the KGB and GRU were to collaborate in a global operation codenamed Ryan, a newly devised acronym called, forgive me, Raketno Yadernoye Napadenie, which in English translates to nuclear missile attack. Its purpose was to collect intelligence on plans by the United States and NATO for a surprise nuclear first strike against the Soviet Union. And then Andrew ends it by saying, in reality, no such plans existed. Okay? So, this is what we are picking up from Gordievsky. This is the first piece in the puzzle for Reagan in terms of what he's learning about the so-called evil empire. And then what we do is we turn to the Vetrov case. This is the face farewell case. And as one French author writes, he says his betrayal, Vetrov's betrayal, was one of the major cataclysms that struck the KGB edifice. He described it as the systematic, he provided information about the, quote, the systematic pillage practiced by the Soviet Union, the scope of which was such that it challenged NATO policies regarding defense and security. In particular, about the radar system protecting the territory of the United States, now totally documented by the KGB. In addition to that, he provided information about particle beam weapons, simulation software for weapon systems, stealth aircraft, millimeter wave. I could go on and on and on. He was providing information. It's a remarkable case. It has all the earmarks of a Hollywood movie, but it's a true story. And essentially what happened was you had a disgruntled employee. That's basically what we're talking about here. Vetrov was stuck in the Soviet Union. He had gotten into trouble when he was in France. He was a KGB officer, a Line X officer. He got stuck. He ran into trouble. It's unclear. Ran into trouble in Ottawa, went back, remained in the KGB at what was called the deputy head of Directorate T, which was the analytical branch of the FCD's S&T operation. So he had access to all of it worldwide. And what does he decide to do? Give it to the French. And it's a remarkable, remarkable story. I won't go into it because it's just too involved. He gave away the French 3,000 documents. Now, what's the Reagan connection? The Reagan connection is that when Reagan was elected in 1981, someone else was elected at the same time, François Mitterrand in France. François Mitterrand had a reputation. The American government was very, very fearful, as were the British, that because of his leftist tendencies, Mitterrand wanted to make peace with the Reagan administration. In July of 1981, he meets privately with Reagan at the G7 meeting, and he tells Reagan, G7 meeting in Ottawa, and he tells Reagan about farewell. And Reagan's not clear about it. There were translation issues, but he knew he was on to something. So this opens the door to farewell and the United States. A month later, Marcel Chalet, who is the director of DST, this was a DST case. They ran him internally successfully. The DST, which is the equivalent of the FBI, ran him in Moscow successfully. And it was only years later when Vetrov was already in jail for having beaten his girlfriend up. It's a complicated story. He's in jail. That's when the whole thing begins to tumble and fall. Okay, so he provides us with this information about what is going on. Okay, so Webster, who's the director of the FBI, Casey, who is the director of CIA, they are briefed by Chalet in 1981, and all of this begins to come out. Okay, let's roll the camera forward a little bit further. April of 1963, the French government expels 47 KGB and GRU officers as a direct result of the Vetrov affair. They are in a position now where they want to make use of this material, and they expel the KGB and the GRU, decimate them in France. Now, where it really begins to come together is on May 20th, 1985. In May 20th, 1985, the famous day, it's the day that John Walker is arrested. And the Walker arrest is all over the spotlight. It's all over the news. Not only because of the fact that it was a KGB recruitment and an arrest, but the nature of the case kept it in the news for the next 2 years. Why? Because you had John Walker, and then you had John Walker's son arrested about a week or two later, and then you had John Walker's brother, Arthur Walker, arrested about a month later, and then you had another year, oh, maybe 6 months, because they didn't have quite enough to get another one of the horror shows, and that was Jerry Whitworth, and they arrested him. And if you remember, it stayed in the press for a very long time, because at the time, Defense Secretary Caspar Weinberger authorized or agreed to allow Walker to plead to a life sentence in exchange for his testimony against Whitworth. And that was the case that caused John Layman, who was the Secretary of the Navy, to resign from his position as Secretary of the Navy in protest against Weinberger's actions. So all of this is staying in the press. But it's important. It's important because now the government is talking about this. And the government is talking. And the Secretary of Defense, Caspar Weinberger, orders a commission to take a look at the DOD security, how they handle security in DOD. The Senate Select Committee had already started an investigation into this in May, and then the Walker case occurred. And then what happens in July of 1985? Vitaly Yurchenko defects. And what does Yurchenko tell us? Yurchenko, for those of you not familiar with him, was a line KR. He was in the first chief directorate. He was a line KR officer, meaning he was a counterintelligence officer in the first chief directorate. He served right down here, two tours of duty. He tells us about unknown subject codename Long. Long turns out to be Ronald Pelton at NSA. NSA was, Pelton had access, Pelton walked in to the Soviets here in the embassy in Washington in January of 1980, and he gives up the project codename Ivy Bells. What is Ivy Bells? Ivy Bells is the underwater cable underneath the Sea of Okhotsk, which allowed the NSA to listen to the Soviet Northern Fleet real time. Gone. Disappears. Tells us about Edward Lee Howard. Edward Lee Howard was a case officer, or about to be a case officer in the CIA, first posting to Moscow. He's fired by CIA, and before being fired, CIA, for whatever reason, gave up their list of assets inside Moscow. I know why they did it. They were losing sources in there, and he was a first tour officer, and they felt they wouldn't know who he was. And what does he give up for the third time? He gives up the fact that Victor Shadrin, a double agent who was kidnapped off the streets of Vienna, was murdered by the KGB in trying to kidnap him. Now, this is what is going on his watch, okay? At the same time, he's being informed, or the government is now learning, the Reagan administration is learning, that this here, despite all the activity we see, is a denied area for them, is a denied area for the KGB and for the GRU. A denied area in the sense that unless it's an emergency situation, the KGB is only, and GRU are only going to handle impersonal contacts here in the in the United States in general. How do we know this? We know this from our own experience, and we also know that the size of their presence here makes it far easier for them to operate. And we know this because the individual who was handling Walker was a KGB officer by the name of Alexei Takshenko, whose only job it was to service Walker's dead drops two or three times a year. He, in the FBI's list, was a Category D, as in Delta. We weren't even paying attention to them. That's the ability that they had at this time. Okay? So beginning in the end of 1985, the Defense Department is conducting reviews. The Senate Select Committee is conducting reviews. The White House is conducting reviews, and they are interested in a response. They want to tighten things up as far as KGB and GRU operations here in the United States. So there are a series of reviews, a series of options provided to the president. The president essentially rejects them all. And what the president wants to do is essentially balance the scale. He recognizes that, President Reagan recognizes that in point of fact, because he's being told this, we could add FBI agents, we could add FBI resources, but we are never going to be able to arrive at a balance. They're always going to have far greater resources here than we can ever match. So the effort is to do what? The effort is to try and reduce that level. So efforts are underway. Efforts are underway to begin to attempt to reduce this. Now, for simplicity's sake, what I want to do is just kind of walk you through the daisy chain. By this time, more money is going into FBI training, more money is going into recruitment of agents into the FBI for CI purposes. But there's also the behind-the-scenes issue of attempting to reduce, for the very, very first time in history, the complement of KGB and GRU presence here in the United States. So we kind of walk you through, if you don't mind, I'll just sort of walk you through the chronology here. And it really begins in August of 1986. On August 30th, 1986, Gennady Zakharov was an employee at the UN Secretariat. He recruited, or tried to recruit, a student, I think at Columbia University, on the Columbia University campus, and attempted to get him to provide intelligence information. That was, in effect, the start of the snowball rolling down the hill. The FBI arrested him on August 30th, 1986. 4 days later, 4 days later, 5 days later, the Soviets overreach. And they overreach by arresting Nicholas Danilov. Danilov was a journalist for the U.S. News and World Report. And they claimed that he obtained information from classified information from a source, and that he was a CIA source. The CIA, in effect, goes to the president. Fortunately, at this particular time, Casey is also a close personal friend of the president. They tell the president CIA had nothing to do with this at all. Okay? Whoops, excuse me. Moving forward, September 12th, 1986. Following diplomatic discussions, Danilov and Zakharov are released into the custody of their respective ambassadors pending at court action. September 13th, 1986, the next day, in response to press inquiries concerning the pending departure of the first 25 Soviets from the mission due to go on October 1st, they're talking about reducing the numbers here, Soviet Ambassador Belaganov advises that the Soviet government had no intention of complying with the, quote, illegal order, and the U.S. still had time to withdraw from this policy decision. 3 days later, in direct response to Belaganov's comments, the president decided to have the FBI select the first 25 to depart from New York on October 6th. The next day, September 17th, Ambassador Belaganov was given the names of 25 KGB and GRU officers in New York who must depart the U.S. by October 1st of 86. The next day, the Soviets were privately advised that the New York expulsions had nothing to do with Soviet-U.S. bilateral diplomatic presence. Accordingly, if the Soviets were to expel any U.S. diplomats in response to the 25 Soviets ordered to depart New York, the U.S. would reduce the Soviet bilateral presence from 320 to 251, which was the number of U.S. diplomats in the Soviet Union. The Soviets protested, and I love this line, the Soviets protested, but were told this was not a threat, but a simple fact in a presidential decision. So all options are open. Okay? September 19th, please stay with me, September 19th, Edward Shevardnadze, the foreign minister, is in the Oval Office, and Reagan advised Shevardnadze that Danilov was not connected with the CIA and all bilateral issues would be on hold until he was released. Talking about playing hardball, okay? September 20th, the next day, Zakharov pleads nolo contendere, and he's returned to the Soviet Union. Danilov was returned to the U.S. not pleading to any charges and accompanied by Yuri Orlov, the famous refusnik, who later became another major thorn in the Russian side. Okay? So, what happens a month later? By now, Gorbachev is in office. And Gorbachev invites the president to the first summit in Iceland. So all of this is going on, not under the radar, but all of this is going on, and he calls the Soviet bluff, in effect. And what he does is he says, we're going to go through this, and the Soviets have to weigh it. And the Soviets, in effect, said, we're going to have to eat this because we need the summit. I mean, he was a true gambler. Now, When this took place, bear with me, when this took place after the expulsions, and I think this sums it up very, very well, when the expulsions took place, there it is, 5 days later there was an editorial in the Washington Post, and it was a lead editorial in the Post. And it stated that over the years, successive American administrations allowed the Kremlin to build an immense espionage presence in the United States. Each time the matter came up in the American government, the determination was that there wasn't very much to do about it. The spy presence became, in fact, part of the furniture in the room of the Soviet-American relations. But it was always wrong, and President Reagan was right finally to do something about it. The route by which he arrived at this decision seems a bit obscure, but two broad considerations are evident. He made clear to the Soviets that he was serious and that their effort to keep expulsion within the familiar and ostensibly fair tit-for-tat context was no longer acceptable, since it gives a permanent and demonstrably unfair advantage to the side that most loads up its diplomatic billets and spies. And he waited for an opportune moment when the Soviets had been drawn into negotiations on other matters that hold out promise to them. Very, very clever. Now, let me close by looking at, we looked at some of the strategic successes, and I'd just like to close by taking a look at the tactical successes and the tactical results of this. What did I do with it? Bear with me. Yeah, here we are. I'm sorry. When Reagan finally left office, in effect, what was his legacy? When he left office, we were pursuing KGB officers in this country and GRU officers with abandon. We were going after them. We had developed operations against them. I can't go into detail. But we were basically given our lead and told to recruit. Okay. Number two, we had captured large quantities of information on recruits that we already had. During the Reagan administration, we had recruited, here in Washington Field that we know of, we had recruited Viktor Martyanov, who was a Line X officer, KGB Line X officer, and at the same time, I'm talking about CIA and FBI, had recruited Sergei Matorin, who was another KGB officer. So we're obtaining information from them real time. And in the words of one officer, Soviet intelligence in the U.S., by the time Reagan left office, Soviet intelligence in the U.S. was weakened to a level, quote, that it had not seen since the early 1930s, when President Roosevelt reestablished diplomatic relations with Stalinist Russia, unquote. Okay? At the same time, let's look at it on a macro level, the KGB and GRU had been severely weakened. They lost, Vetrov himself gave up 225 KGB officers, S&T officers worldwide. So they were identified. KGB and GRU operations had been severely weakened in France and other countries through the world through Vetrov. And finally, he helped lay the groundwork for the larger story of the collapse of the Soviet Union. Now, I kind of overstepped myself, got ahead of myself a little bit, forgive me. But what were his tactical accomplishments? Well, August of 1985, as John pointed out, August of 1985, we see the creation of the first director of counterintelligence activities or counterintelligence programs in the White House, which still stands today. A significant increase in focus of FBI special agents recruited for counterintelligence purposes. Vast, and I can tell you this from my own experience, because by 1985, I was the supervisor of the counterintelligence and counterterrorism program in Baltimore. And I had John Walker on my squad, I had Pelton on my squad, a number of these characters. So, and we began to see a significant increase. And just the tone of the Reagan administration made, improved the morale of people within the FBI tremendously. But we saw a vastly increased training of FBI personnel. We saw for the very first time, we kind of take it for granted today, diplomatic license plates. It was Reagan who ordered all establishments to have diplomatic license. You know, you have the letter number designation, that special letter designation, number designation. He also re-energized or created, if you will, the Office of Foreign Missions at the Department of State, and to put his stamp on it, to make sure that everyone understood how serious he was, he asked Jim Nolan, who was the deputy assistant director for operations in the intelligence division of the FBI, to come over and to run the Office of Foreign Missions with the full rank and privileges of a U.S. ambassador. So it was Ambassador James Nolan. All diplomatic travel would be controlled by the Office of Foreign Missions. Unlike in the past, we would find out after the fact that someone had traveled to some place. No longer. They had a 25-mile limit. If they went out of that 25-mile limit, with one or two little caveats, and they were very, very strict, if they went out of that 25-mile limit, they were flying someplace, Office of Foreign Missions would make their airline reservations, would purchase their rental cars at the airport, would arrange for their hotel rooms, and essentially give them the routes that they were required to take when they travel, really tightening it down on them. All purchases over a specific amount of money were to be handled by the Office of Foreign Missions. They could not do any purchasing on their own. And we saw, just in conclusion, we saw increased budget for technical development and an increased budget for training in security throughout the government. So that sort of sums up, if you will, just in the short time that I had, the story in part. I mean, there's much, much more here that we don't have an opportunity to go into. And I started off my comments with a humorous story, and I'd sort of like to end with this. Whereas I gave you sort of a story that goes back to Abraham Lincoln about George Washington and Ethan Allen, I want to tell you a quick story that actually goes back to one of the great Borscht Belt comedians who I have absolutely loved, by the name of Hal Cantor. He was a great comedian. He was actually a better comedy writer. He was actually more successful as a comedy writer. And he told a great story about a guy walking down the street. And he's walking down the street and he passes a house. And here's a sign on the front lawn of the house in the yard. And it says, "Talking dog for sale." So he's puzzled by this, so he goes and he knocks on the door. Okay, guy opens the door, walks in, and he says, "I saw your sign, Talking Dog for Sale." He says, "Yeah, come on out, show me in the back." He says, "Yeah, I'd love to see him." So anyway, he goes out there, and he has this enormous German Shepherd just sitting there, just very proud and pleased as can be. And the guy tells me, "You talk." He says, "Oh yes, I talk very well." Guy is almost dumbstruck looking at this dog. He said, "Well, tell me something about yourself." He said, "Well, when I was young, I worked for the police department. I always had a need to serve the public." So he said, as a young dog, I worked with the police department. If there was a barricade situation, they would send me there. I'd go in, I'd put the clamp on that guy, and the cops would arrest him. He says, "Then I got a little bit older, and I sort of served as a dog for people who are visually impaired, and that was a little bit easier on me, and so I did that for a number of years. And then later on, I became a petting dog. People who are in despair, dogs are a wonderful way to sort of lower their blood pressure and ease them. And now I'm just living here with this fellow and enjoying myself." And he says, "That's absolutely amazing." And he looks at the guy, he says, "Why are you selling him?" He says, "What do you mean?" He said, "You can't believe it, a word he says." Well, that kind of brings us full circle to Ronald Reagan, because the Soviets believed everything Ronald Reagan said. Okay? And it was Ronald Reagan, really, in my opinion, who who truly laid the groundwork for the end of the at the collapse of the Soviet Union 3 or 4 years later. And it was the counterintelligence role that he played, the demonstrable counterintelligence heroism and leadership that he demonstrated during his term of office, that is a legacy for everybody and is a legacy for anyone who ever wants to study the White House, the presidency, and national security matters. So with that, I thank you, and I certainly open it to questions if you'd like that.